try to go sit down in my
chair. Say that again.
Someone try to sit in my chair. Usually, okay. Elena don't like when I sit down.
Yeah.
Oh, but not my studio over.
Welcome in, everybody. Happy Thursday.
It's funny.
Hope you all are doing well. It's a family affair today. You can see Trey's got his daughter with him. I'm the happy father of two now. My wife just had our second daughter on Monday, so we just got back from the hospital yesterday and catching up on some sleep the last few nights. But it feels good to be home. So we're hoping all y'all are doing well. As usual, though, this is our weekly live session, an opportunity for you to come in and ask us questions. In regards to any issues or concerns that you're seeing or having with your kids going through the 30-day program, the 60-day program, any of those programs, now is a great time to ask questions and hopefully get the answers that you need.
We should have a lot of people going or having games and having, you know, in-game at-bats to talk about. You know,
correct.
That's what we've been getting a lot.
There you go.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, like Trey was saying, a lot of folks are getting into games, having game at bats, game situation, things that they're, I mean, real life situations that are getting them. A lot of times it could be pitch location, struggling with solid contact in games. A lot of folks, they go through this program and they experience so much improvement. Their bat speed gets so much better that they're literally having their bat in and out of the zone so fast before the ball ever gets to the plate. So it does take time to transition that new swing into the games and really get a comfortable feel for it. So like he said, we know a lot of y'all are experiencing things like that too. So any questions you have along those lines, feel free to ask them. You can type them in the chat box or in the reaction section, click raise your hand and we'll be able to unmute you and talk to you audibly. Still have some folks joining us too. So I'll tell you what we will do to get the ball rolling. Our first question, we'll hit you up with a 10% discount code.
Oh boy.
Oh boy. Somebody needs a tea, I know.
Yeah, some random question. It'd be funny.
Don't take but one.
I did talk to Wes.
Yeah.
I talked to Wes earlier today. Saw our video about Bellinger. I said we might catch some flack for this. He said, you will, but it's 100% true. So
it is.
He approved of it.
It is true. There's one. Justin, email me, dude. I'll send you my email so you can get that discount code. But email me and I'll get you your discount code. He asked the question, what's the best way to start utilizing the CamWood bat while coaching an entire team? A great question. I love this question because I really like to see folks implementing it in a team aspect because – you're going to really change it on a larger scale when you start going and implementing it with teams. As usual, though, I would typically start kind of the same way we do with kids, starting out with the one-hander and making sure that they understand why they're using the bats, why we train that. The number one thing is to help us stay inside often easier, the most consistent way so that we can keep our sweet spot in line with the ball and in the hitting zone as long as possible to maximize our opportunity for solid contact. So again, starting with the one-hander, teaching them that the bottom hand has to lead the swing, It has to be a straight path from A to B, trying to get the full extension and feeling that bat release naturally through the zone rather than forcing that barrel over the top. I'm a big proponent of the one-hander, honestly, because I think you could change a kid's swing with just that bat. Just because a lot of kids don't know how to use their bottom hand in the swing, you would be able to drastically see a difference in all of your kids by starting with that one-hand trainer. So I would kind of keep the same lines. You may have you may have to change the schedule a little bit. And what I mean by that is you're obviously going to be probably more in a group setting. You're not going to have as much time to spend with each kid. So time may be limited. But again, keep it kind of the same way. Start with the one-hander, couple days, couple weeks with that, adding the two-hander in as you go. Once they get a good feel for their hands, move into the lower half and then start implementing the whole thing together.
Whenever we implement this, like in a big group setting, so like whenever we do our camps and all that stuff, you know, we try to break the kids out into no more than three per group. Mm-hmm. That way kids can just continuously get reps in. And, you know, in this instance, you know, me and Jonathan would be going from group to group, watching the kids do it, and we'll be critiquing as we go. But in a coach setting, you know, it's very easy to just teach the other assistant coaches that you have this process and what to look mm-hmm. for while drills. So, you know, you can have it broken up into four or five different groups, and then you and another coach go around making sure everyone's doing the stuff properly.
That brings up a great that's point. Right there, talking about you, I mean, teaching it to other coaches. I mean, if you have a coaching staff of 2, 3, 4 guys or girls, whatever, I mean, baseball or softball, it'd be a lot easier to take that core group of coaches and teach the system to them, help them understand it, help them understand what they're looking for. Good cues to use to get the improvement that you want to see, and then bust them up into 3 or 4 groups of however many kids, like Trey said, max 3 or 4 kids a group, and let each of those coaches kind of take a group through the program. You'd be able to kind of hit it at a larger scale that way for sure.
Yeah, I know with me, like I've worked with 8 players at once, me by myself. And all I did, if I had 2 cages, I would sit in the middle of the cage and I would have 4 groups of 2 players hitting opposite directions. So me sitting in the middle, I could see all 4 groups. Yourself, there's ways you can also have at that point. I know some coaches only buy 1 cam with our team, and if that's the case, then you know you would want to cycle through it to where they're working on their hands. But it'd be a lot tougher if you only had 1 cam. Would obviously cycle everybody through and making sure stuff gets done properly.
Yeah. How do we know if the current bat is too heavy? Go ahead, Trey.
Yeah, I think a lot of the people when they reach out to me is like, said they buy that 1 CamWood for like their entire team, trying to, which it'll still work, but it's just not as effective as, you know, if majority people on the team or a lot of people on the team have them.
Another question here. How do we know if the current bat is too heavy? When do I move from the U31 to the 31 adult? 31 adult, we tell people most of the time when they go to a drop 5 or a drop 3 game bat, go ahead and go to the adult model because they're getting ready to go up to a heavier weighted game bat. So we want to be able to kind of prepare for that, meet that head on. If they're swinging drop 8s, drop 10s, keep them at that 31-inch youth. Sometimes you'll see, we'll see kids, 13-year-olds still swinging a 31-inch youth. If they're a bigger size 13-year-old, and the 31-inch youth seems to be fairly easy for them to swing, go ahead and move them up to that 31-inch adult. Don't sit there and let them get complacent with that simple 31-inch, that light bat. Get them a bat that's got a little more weight to it, a little heavier, and let them go from there.
I know personally that's where I struggled, was making that transition. I was always a really good hitter. And then once I had to pick up that drop 3, I had no clue what to do. So I said, I lean more on the side of, if you're about to make that transition, go ahead and get the adult model, because it's going to help you move into that drop three or whenever you have to make that transition when you turn right around 13, 14 years old. Because that was like a game changer for me, is whenever I had to make that transition. It was so hard to swing that heavy bat. I just wasn't used to it.
Good question. Still got a few folks joining us too. So if you're just now popping in, if you're new to the group, this is our weekly live session, an opportunity for you to ask questions about the 30-day program or any issues that your kids are seeing with that program or the 60-day program. Now is a great time to get the answers that you're looking for. I saw this today, Trey. Fun fact, the major league batting average across the board is 230 right now.
Yeah, that's always nice. I actually saw they did something to the baseball because they're not flying the way they did last year. So
really?
You're seeing a lot of, I think, are home runs, and they're getting caught. So
wow.
If that did change the averages, are going to just plummet this year. They'll be lower than last season. Easy.
Here's one right here. Is it okay for smaller 6U kids to use the one-hander bat for the program, like use it with two hands? Absolutely. We do see sometimes, I mean, 6-year-olds, maybe even some 7-year-olds, depending on their size, they do have trouble going right into the one-hand drill. The one-hand bat's too heavy to swing with one hand, so I let them use two hands and just kind of start with the two-hand drill, keeping the same concept, trying to drive that bottom hand, making them emphasize the lead hand, but using two hands to do it. Once they get a little bit stronger, probably a week or two after swinging that one-hander with two hands, some of them will be able to go ahead and start swinging it with one hand. Some it may take a little longer than that, but by all means, if the one hander is too heavy for one hand, then use two.
Yeah, and we also do have smaller, I mean, we have a T-ball version, which is a 24-inch, because the one hander is 20 inches. So we do have some players that prefer that T-ball size, which is 24. But if not, the old softball one-hander is the exact same bat as the T-ball bat. 26 ounces. So that's also an option for you.
Another one here. Best drill to get power into the swing. Our son has a great swing, makes good contact, but he doesn't have much power compared to the other players his age. I'm going to go right to the lower half. That's something I struggled with my entire career, truthfully. I was a smaller player, not necessarily height, but just overall size. I wasn't real big. I mean, as you can see, I mean, I'm jacked now, but I wasn't real big when I was playing. And it was because of lack of lower half. I didn't understand lower half. I didn't understand weight shift. I naturally understood rotation, but it was because of the things I was taught. But if they're having trouble with power, it's because they're not starting the swing from the knee. They're not getting that good weight shift into the swing, which is cutting down their extension. It's not allowing them to really get extended on inside pitches, which is where they're going to see some of their power. But on the outside pitch, if all you have is your hand, I mean, you're going to lose a little bit of strength there. So again, I would make sure that we focus on the weight shift drill, understanding how to fire that knee first and let the hands follow. Same thing with the pipe, how to fire that hip and then let the hands follow. Really focus on hitting against the stiff front side. But other than that, I mean, Trey would talk probably a little bit about extension. That's going to be a power killer too. If they're not getting full extension on the ball, if they're pulling off, they're going to lose a lot of power on that too.
Yeah, I know. Mike, I always tell people all the time, where does power come from? The majority of the answers you're going to get is from your lower half. And it's just not the case. The ball is going to go further from your hands and getting good extension out front than it is with your lower half. And the reason I say that is because my hitting coach took me out onto the field and we did a test. So we did our no feet, no shoulders, and I would just swing with just my hands. So I would use no lower half at all. And we would see the flight of the ball. And he would say, okay, now use your lower half, do your entire swing. And then we see the flight of the ball there. And whenever I'm using my lower half, the ball only went about 30% further than with just my hands. So yes, you do get from, but it's not power. So, you know, where's the majority of of your power come from is catch the ball out front and getting that good extension. And I'm sure you'll see players all the time, and me included. If I get fooled on an off speed pitch, I'm way out front. I have no lower half in the swing. I just flick my hands at it. I can still hit the ball 400 feet. So it's more so on the extension part, catching the ball out front, not letting it get too deep. But the other thing, like Jonathan was saying, is I see a ton of players that just rotate with the lower half instead of get that drive with the knee and get the momentum going through the ball. So a player that, you know, I can watch their swing, if they're all hands, the ball is not going to go as far as if when they sync up the lower half properly with the hands, it'll go a little bit further. So, you know, if he has good mechanics already, he has good leg drive, you know, all of his momentum's going through the ball and he still doesn't have as much power, well, it's probably just because he's a smaller kid, you know. And the way we're going to combat that is just from continuing to use the CamWood bat and getting stronger. So if he's focusing on just the bat speed aspect of it, of power, I would say do two and twos, two swings with the CamWood, two swings with the game bat, and keep alternating and really focus on it. And whenever you're doing that drill, do it 110% every single swing. I mean, swing as hard as you absolutely can every time, because that's how you're going to develop the bat speed and the power by doing that drill. So I would have to see a swing from him just to see exactly where it comes from and be able to tell you and pinpoint it. But it's more than likely one of those things. If I had to take a guess, I'd say he's not really getting the weight shift into the swing, because a lot of players struggle with that. I mean, college players struggle with that.
Yeah.
So if I had to, that would probably be my pick. Because that was Jonathan's pick. He would just rotate back half. He never got his momentum going through the ball. And he still had pop because he would catch the ball out front and get extended. Mm-hmm. But if he would have had that weight shift, you know, he could have hit 8 to 10 home runs in the season.
I'm one of those that, I mean, I needed my lower half for that extra 30% of power. Like you said, I got extension, but I wasn't a big enough kid that extension made the ball go that far for me. I had to have lower half because I wanted it to jump. And that's something that I didn't really understand until now. So, again, like Trey says, it's going to be extension or it's going to be lower half for sure. And, yes, I think he asked the same question. Can he post a video and a game video on Facebook for comments? Absolutely. Yeah, do that and tag us in the comments of that video. That way we'll get notified as soon as you post it. But, yeah, we'll comment on that for sure.
And you can also post in our group as well. You don't have
Discord too.
Because that's where I hang out mostly is our Discord. So – it's just a lot easier to communicate in that Discord as opposed to that Facebook group. So I prefer Discord over Facebook.
Another question here from Justin says, how many times are you recommending to do the two and two drill?
I mean, it just depends on the player, honestly, depending on how tired they get. Me personally, I'd do about 100 swings, 50 with the CamWood, 50 with the game bat. But I go a little overboard sometimes. I would just say gauge with the player. Because obviously if they get too tired, now they're, you know, bad habits and all that good stuff. So I would just gauge it with them. I tell my high school kids that have already gone through the 30-day program that whenever they go and do their cage sessions, always finish it off with two rounds of the bat speed drill, 30 balls apiece. So that's 60 swings that I tell my high schoolers to do. But I know I did this with one of my high school kids where we just focused on bat speed, where we did the bat speed drill for a week straight. You know, we would do 100 swings each day for 7 days. He gained 9 miles an hour in 7 days doing that. So very powerful. I know, Jonathan, you worked with a kid. He gained, what, 4 or 5 miles an hour?
4 miles an hour. And that's a kid that's never – I mean, he never picked up a CamWood, has never been through the program. He was a senior in high school, so he's a kid that, I mean, at some point – I see this more so with the older kids. At some point, you've got to address mechanics first because the stronger they are and the longer their swing is, it's going to kill their bat speed. But for him, just by grabbing the CamWood and doing the 2-and-2 drill for 2 weeks, he saw 4 miles an hour to his average exit velocity. I mean,
yeah, that's not even top speed.
Yeah, that's not even top speed. He topped out at like 89, but his average was 84, 85, and it was just consistent. You could tell the consistency from the beginning to the end of how much easier it was for him to just put his barrel in the right spot naturally.
Like I said, a good point is the a lot of times I want to start with the mechanics. Like if you have good mechanics, you're more likely to build bat speed and power quicker, which is why I'm kind of teetering with taking off that bat speed challenge, because people are doing the bat speed challenge instead of the All-American, which the All-American program is going to give you way more results than the bat speed challenge is going to give you. So it's been confusing a lot of customers that see that, and they're like, well, which one should I go through first? Hey, girl. You're okay.
Trey, Justin says he just joined the Discord group earlier today, but it says he does not have permission to see any posts. Did he miss a step somewhere? Oh, has it muted you? I see it.
Yeah.
Try it now.
Hear me?
Yep.
So on the Discord, the very first thing that you see, it should be like the rules of the Discord. All you have to do is click the little emoji on the bottom. Maybe I think it's a green check mark that you agree to the terms of the Discord, and then it'll unlock everything for you. See if that works real quick before you get off. Let me see. Whenever you join the Discord, I make you accept the terms. So I get something. Girl. Come here. Probably once or more.
Don't be shy.
She's woke up from a nap, so. Jeez.
I wake up the same way.
Yeah. Man, I tell you, I get angry if I get woken up. Like.
Yeah, mine's over here. My oldest one's over here shelling out, too. Yeah, she's still getting used to the newness.
Did that work for you, Justin? He should be good.
Yes, yeah, he did it. Jose has a question here. He said, CamWood is great. What can I do drill-wise to stop stepping in the bucket? Coach Chen Yu, they all step out. Number one thing I would do is I would cut the stride out. I go – whenever kids have that issue with stepping out, I widen their feet out to a point to where all they have to do is rock their weight back. I don't really give them the option to pick their foot up and put it down, because if you give them that option, if they pick it up, it's going out. So just make them leave that front foot in the ground, get their weight on the backside, and then just hit against the stiff front leg. Widening their feet out a lot of times is going to help cut that out. Some of them may get back in. Go ahead, Trey.
I was going to say, I used to have an open stance. And
yeah,
whenever I started working with Frank, he completely cut that out, because you're just adding extra stuff to the swing that can go wrong. So he had me literally, like you said, like widen my stance up just a little bit, not too wide, you know, not Jeff Bagwell style. But just spread out a little bit and then pick the foot up and put it right back down, you know, just for the weight transfer to get the weight on the back leg. And chance to step out with my foot because I would just pick it up and go right back down, you know. Mm-hmm. So that would be something very easy, is just to have them focus on their weight shift of picking it up and putting it back down. She didn't like what I was saying.
That should help you, though, Jose.
No, I mean, I see people all the time put anything behind the player, too, like a bat, where if they step out, they step on the bat type thing.
Yeah, yeah.
But all this stuff comes with reps, too. I'll tell you that. You're not going to tell a kid that time and then it fixes it. I mean, it's going to take consistent reps of them doing this new thing to get that out.
Yeah.
Hey, girl. You okay?
Here's another one. Do we have any in-person hitting camps planned or scheduled for this summer? I'm in California, but willing to travel for a camp. My daughter completed the 30-day program, and we feel it would be good to work with you guys to work on more in-person hitting details. We do not have anything necessarily scheduled. Obviously, I mean, we talk about this somewhat regularly in the group now, as a lot of folks are getting curious about it. A lot of folks are kind of wanting it. The biggest thing, like we always talk about, is making sure we have the right number of kids for us to travel. Making sure that we get into somewhat of a central location would be the best thing for us to get the right number of kids. 100 kids is what we normally shoot for at these camps. So, I mean, again, we would love to do one this summer. We're not opposed to announcing one. We just kind of need a few ideas for dates. We don't really like to announce it and pick dates because sometimes they fill, sometimes they don't. And we want to really come to where you guys are. So wherever you want us to come, let us know. And we can put some feelers out in those locations to hopefully fill those camps.
We're also working on certifying coaches as well. So if you're a coach and you want to come to us and learn how we coach players, it'll be a 2-day event. If that's something you're interested in, just let us know, because that's something we're looking at doing. So instead of us, you know, traveling around and coaching with players, we could have a bigger impact by coaching coaches and, you know, spread the CamWood philosophy a lot quicker that way.
Yeah. The coaches are going to stay in that location. So, I mean, they'll come to us, they'll learn it. They're going to go back to their hometowns. And a lot of times, hopefully the plan for that is for you to be in one of those hometowns so that they're as close as they can be to you. Like you mentioned, I mean, in-person hitting details. We've done this stuff online. We've done this virtually with different people, and we do see improvements that way. You can see improvements that way, but you are going to see more and more results, faster improvement with in-person training than you are virtual, for sure. I mean, that is, I stand by that 100%. This stuff is so much of a feel thing that if, a lot of times if you can't put your hands on them and make the kids feel what you're trying to get them to do, you're just going to keep banging your head against the wall saying the same thing over and over and over and over again. They're going to see improvement because the bats are built the way they are, and eventually the kid's going to feel it, but it's just going to take that much longer to see the results you want to see. Any other questions?
My Discord name is Trey Sykes. You can't miss me. I'm the only one in there that's red. So, why did it sound country as hell when I said that?
Hey, man. Be real, dog. Be real.
Yeah, speaking of Wes, Jonathan, in your Discord, probably put CamWood coach or something behind her camera.
I will out to the side. I'll do that just out to the side.
I made y'all green, so only the CamWood coaches are the green color, but people might not know that whenever they first enter in. I told Frank I need to get him in there. talking to everybody.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Frank would have a blast.
Yeah, you should hear some of his shirt designs.
Oh, I bet they're nuts.
Oh, they are. We might get sued.
I believe it.
They said that we're definitely going to start working on the certifying coaches. So once that comes out, we'll be sending an email out to our list. So you'll see it in an email or a text message that we send out. They were going to only cap it at 30 coaches, though. So we want to keep it intimate. I don't want too many people there because then it's going to ruin the experience. There's too many. Boy, my arm hurt.
Here's a question. Jose asked on our thoughts of using a tee versus hitting a heavy bag when going through the 30-day program. Also, how will the bat hold up on this thing? And by this thing, it's basically you've seen one of these things before, Trey. It's like a Skills tee with the little plastic rod that comes out, a little plastic yellow ball on the end of it. And you kind of hit it, and it swings around and comes back.
Oh, those things? I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. I mean, if you hit it on the sweet spot, I mean, it's probably going to hold up like anything else. I mean, I would think it's a wood bat.
It's just like a normal wood bat. So.
Yeah.
It'll definitely
Again,
hold up.
Those things are made to, I mean, made for, I mean, bats. So you're not going to necessarily break that bat. As far as the weighted bag goes, again, I don't necessarily have any reservations on that either. You're basically talking about like a punching bag type deal is what I'm visualizing. Yeah. And again, that's just a big, big, heavy piece of
cloth. I know Mo Vaughn uses those a lot.
Right. So, I mean, he's a CamWood guy. He's banged these things a lot. So you're not going to have any issues with that. If you're going through the 30-day program with the punching bag, I would make sure to put some form of a mark about the size of a ball. So they have a base, I guess, a visual for where they're actually going and they're not just swinging. Give them some form of direction, some sense of a target point of what they're trying to hit or where they're trying to make contact at. And then just go through the program. You're going to – the only thing difference you're going to see there is you're not going to be able to feel the bat release and get all the width that we want through that because it's going to hit that bag and it's going to stop. But, yeah, you could go through the drills with that if that's all you have,
James,
for sure.
I'll say, James, sorry, my phone moving all around. I just watched the video you just posted in the Discord, and – his mechanics do look really good. So in my perspective, I would just do a lot of two and twos, two with the CamWood, two with the game bat, to really, you know, speed up the hands and increase the strength. You'll see John that you post. He just looks like he might be a smaller kid, which is perfectly fine. He'll develop. But I would focus on the two and twos. He actually does have a good swing. I said in the videos that he sent. Look at the second one. Yeah, he gets in a really good position. So, yeah, I would just do the two and twos with him. Oh. The Discord. That's what I noticed. He's playing up, right, because he has good mechanics. So, I mean, it looks like he probably does hit a lot of nice little line drives, but just because he's smaller in nature, they just don't go as far. But, like I said, the CamWood bat, training with that would definitely help. I would ask, how much do you use the CamWood? Personally, in my opinion, it's the only bat I would ever use while training. I didn't use my aluminum bats at all in cages. If I was playing a game, I would use it. But other than that, I'd be using the CamWood bat because it's just going to build up that strength.
Yeah, I'm a huge advocate of that. Nobody in our facility really picks up their game bats at all. I mean, we're trying to hone the muscle memory more so than anything. I mean, the comfortability of the bat is going to be really determined more upon their confidence level up here and how their body feels I mean, with the actual motion of swinging the bat. You can hand kids a heavier end-loaded bat or a balanced bat. One kid with good mechanics will swing that bat, both bats just about the same way. Somebody who's got a little bit worse or mechanics, you're going to see a difference in the way they swing those bats because one's got weight positioned differently. So I'm a huge advocate of making sure that they swing the CamWood as often as they can.
If they're not
swinging it every day, I would try to do that for sure.
Oh, absolutely. I would do every day for sure. Or at least 5 times a week. You can take days off on weekends.
That's right.
Like before games, 100%. Like, get out there 10, 15, 20 minutes before a game and make sure you get your swings in with the CamWood. That way you're reassuring your mechanics, taking the hands to the ball, all that good stuff. But I just posted the link to the Discord. If y'all are not in there yet, just click on that link and you'll be able to join in. The CamWood you bought is too big. What size did you get? Might have got a size up on accident. You can pull an old Move On. Back in the day, probably about a year and a half ago, whenever Move On started using the CamWood bat, we didn't offer the 26 and the 27 inch. We started at the 28. Well, his son used the 26. So Mo bought the 28 inch CamWood and just cut 2 inches off the end of the bat. So he just made his own 26 inch.
Very true. Very true. He said he don't have the size with him.
Gotcha. But yeah, if it's too big, obviously, I mean, these bats are heavier. So if you get the bigger sizes, it's just even heavier for the kid. Mm-hmm. That's why we always recommend same length that they swing in game. I tell people 1 inch difference isn't that big of a deal, but 2 or more is definitely a big deal. I wouldn't go that far over. Hey, Jonathan, how about that? That just reminded me. Daniel called me texted me. One of the customers that he that bought through him said that the bat was too heavy for her son. Son's 10 years old. Dude bought him an adult 32.
My goodness.
he said because he will grow into it.
Oh,
yeah, man. Yeah, in 5 years.
Lord.
Making sure he gets his money out of that one. Ain't never going back.
Yeah. Hey, here's this tree. Swing it.
Yeah. That's funny.
Oh, my goodness. Lord have mercy. Yeah, that's something that folks do. I mean, we hadn't really had issues. We don't have too many issues with that, but that is – some folks do realize that they buy CamWood bigger on purpose. Like, they're trying to – like, they're buying shoes that they're going to grow into, but they don't realize that the bats are, like, 45 ounces, the adult models. I mean, they're plus 12. They are heavy.
Yeah.
They're heavy. So you don't have to necessarily, plan ahead. I mean, you go the same size and it all kind of works out in the end.
That's why I said you're way better off getting, like, say your son swings a 28-inch right now. You're way better off getting that 28-inch. And then when he moves up to the 29, you can still train with that 28.
Yeah, that too. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, there's ways that you can do it, but going up is a little bit more dangerous than the other way.
Any other questions, guys and gals?
I think I hear my son screaming in the parking lot. Yeah, James, just reach out to support. He just sent me a message on Discord about the bat being too big.
Mm-hmm.
So he wants help with getting a new one. So
yeah, reach out to support. We'll help you out. Yeah.
They'll help you out.
I don't know if he's still in here or not. I think he's probably still in here. Any other questions y'all have for us before we sign off for the day?
Looks to be it. Everybody's saying thank you. Hey, thank you all. We appreciate your time just as much as y'all appreciate ours. We do this for y'all. We want to help you as much as we can. Something we've been telling a lot of our customers the last few weeks is that, I mean, you're pretty much getting access to free training when you join up with CamWood. You get lifetime access to the programs. You get access to us. Obviously, you can't see us in person like you'd want to most of the time, but with the resources that you get and the access to us through text message, Discord, things like that, you really do have every single thing you need to see the right improvement, to see the most improvement with this bat and with this program. So keep utilizing the text hotline, keep utilizing this chat every week. And if you have any friends that their kids are struggling, bring them into here. Tell them, I mean, the good news, they need CamWood in their life. So lead them the right way, send them to us. We appreciate all of you, and we look forward to seeing each one of you next week. Y'all have a great weekend. See you next Thursday.